Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to another episode of Boys in the Cave. This podcast is proudly supported by Night Watchman Sports and Muslim Youth Today. My name is Tanzim, and I'm joined by my co-host Josh, and today, alhamdulillah, we have a very, very special guest with us. Before we intro our guest, we want to talk about how you can support this podcast, because as I mentioned in our previous podcast, the team here, we're young Muslim university students, and we don't work full-time, and alhamdulillah, with the help of Allah, we started this podcast with the intention, inshallah, to being for the sake of Allah. However, the intention is to benefit the community, and we know this content is big around US and UK, however, we know in Australia, there is an absence of this platform. And so imagine the costs that take to run this podcast, for example, with the website costs and using Zencaster to get overseas guests and mics. Like, we're only using one mic right now. So inshallah, like, don't want to bore you guys, but the whole idea is that do support us in every way and shape you can. And alhamdulillah, we're getting great messages from everyone and response worldwide. And people do ask, like, how can we support you guys? And the main thing is to basically follow and like us on all our social media pages and give us a review, especially on Facebook. However, the main way of supporting us is through iTunes. And if we go up the rankings in iTunes, more people will be exposed to and more people can benefit from this content, inshallah. So what you can do is to help us on iTunes, just go on to iTunes, leave a 5-star rating and a small review to show your support, inshallah. It only take like 5 minutes, inshallah. And also the other way you can help us in terms of cost, you can become a patron today. So you can go on patreon.com/boysinthecave and you can donate as little as $5 a month. And inshallah, it'll help us grow, you know, getting like other mics and getting more better sound quality, inshallah, just to benefit you. And hopefully you can really be part of this growing community here at Boys in the Cave. So on to our special guest. I hope I didn't bore him too much with that spiel, but to give him a quick intro, he has a degree in languages, majoring in Arabic and English. He has studied classical Arabic under sheikhs. He has done enormous amount of da'wah work through conducting lectures and videos, which are all online, and you can check it out on Muslim Central. He has delivered several intensive courses on jurisprudence, tajweed, and other various Islamic sciences. He is also the co-founder of Al-Firdaus Quran College and is an Arabic and Quran reading instructor. And now he's very well known, especially around Sydney, as an authorized marriage celebrant and marriage counselor, aka the love doctor, counseling people on a daily basis through his office online and social media. So you can check him out on bilaldanoon.com. So assalamu alaikum, Sheikh Bilal Danoon, and welcome to Boys in the Cave.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and thanks for having me here, Brother Tanzim and Brother Joshua.
Thank you so much. Like, especially today we're recording in his office, and subhanAllah, I wish this was like video, right? Inshallah, we'll be in the future, but man, all this like fancy stuff around the room, and it looks like the big deal, and you're getting like really busy and stuff in this office and with all these like marriage counseling, for example. So what's your kind of day-to-day kind of routine like?
Alhamdulillah, well, I think the busiest probably part of my week would be on the weekends, facilitating marriages for people from all walks of life. Alhamdulillah, I've been blessed to tap into people's lives and to make a contribution to their future. So I guess apart from that, I'm busy consulting people with marriage advice, either here at the office or on social media through Skype and other social media platforms. And alhamdulillah, it's so refreshing. And it's so it's such a blessing to be able to make a difference to people's lives, saving their marriages, or helping them make a transition, you know, in one way or another in their relationship. I guess one thing we have to understand that most of a person's happiness, or much of a person's happiness after marriage, will come from their marriage, and much of a person's grief after marriage will also come from their marriage. So it's really important to be married to the right person, to be the right person, inshallah, because marriage does play a massive role in our progress, in life, in our productivity. And the Marital Institute does have a ripple effect on many aspects of our lives. So I really do enjoy speaking to couples and trying my best to ensure win-win outcomes, inshallah. I'm big on saying to couples, you know, change your story, or divorce the past, marry the future. this is something I'm very passionate about. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed me with marriage and a family. And alhamdulillah, we learn from our personal experiences and the experiences of the people around us. And we like to share these experiences and patterns of human behavior with people who are all new to this. So, jazakumullahu khairan for this platform and for allowing me to make a contribution today.
I mean, like, literally, the reason why we wanted to get you on board today is because I literally see it, like, all weddings I go to, subhanAllah.
Yeah, it's funny. Like, a lot of our personal friends, we see you several times a year. It's just that we're in the audience and you probably don't realize us as the guests. But yeah, it's nice to see.
Alhamdulillah. I think one of the reasons I noticed both of you come from a subcontinent background, and I think one of the reasons probably why you would see me more than maybe other celebrants is the fact that they're looking for an English-speaking celebrant who can also connect with the youth of today and understand the culture. I think that's very important for community leaders to be able to connect with the people around them.
Definitely, like, I would say in our community, the subcontinental background that we have, there aren't as many speakers such as yourself who can have that connection to the youth. Like, I remember in a recent Nick Alf, one of my close friends, you said something during the ceremony about how we need to overcome our cultural differences. And that's something very hard for a subcontinental background, like all the uncles and aunties present, to hear that, because it's something that we grapple with a lot. And seeing as that you're not from our culture, you can sort of tell us and tell the youth.
And get away with it.
Probably. Yeah, you can get away with it, yeah. Because if you were part of our community, you'd be crucified for that.
SubhanAllah, that's a well said, yeah.
And I do want to ask this kind of big question, and it's like a big question.
Just to get straight into it, yeah.
Straight into it, yeah. Like, I guess we go through, you know, growing up in the West and being Muslim, and we have this kind of Hollywood vision of what is marriage or what is love. But this is a super big question I've been waiting to ask you ever since, you know, I heard you've agreed to come onto the podcast. So here it is.
Okay.
Is there such thing as true love or even love at first sight? And what's Islam's perspective about this question?
Wow, now that's a loaded question. Thank you for the question. So let's break up the question. Let's unpack the question. What's the first part of the question?
Is there such thing as true love?
True love, of course. When it comes to true love, and we know that there is the concept of love in Islam. Actually, we know that there's a concept of deep love or passionate love in Islam. And subhanAllah, you'll find it written all over the invitation cards that come our way when people are about to get married, when they're quoting from Surah Ar-Rum, and they're quoting that verse, that very beautiful verse whereby Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us of His many amazing signs. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ He says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً And from amongst His signs is that He created for you spouses for you from your own kind, so that you may live in tranquility with them, and He has put between you mawaddah and rahmah. Now, what is mawaddah? Mawaddah actually means passionate or deep love. Deep love. Because we have another word in Arabic, which is mahabba, hub. Hub is love, right? But here we have mawaddah. So yes, it's about being in a passionate marriage, a passionate love, and remembering that that passionate love isn't always going to be, or that love isn't always going to be passionate. And during those moments, we need to remember another very integral element or pillar of a successful and happy marriage, and that is rahmah, which is the mercy. So they work hand in hand. And I like to look at these two as pillars that support healthy, functional marriages. But marital bliss does not rain down from the heavens. So both the couple need to be pouring into this relationship ongoingly, continuously, consistently making contributions that will water this love tank. So with love, let's imagine like every relationship has this love tank, right? And you've got to be pouring into it because, as you know, there's going to be lots of stresses. There's going to be lots of things coming into the marriage. And the tank, the love that's in this tank is going to get depleted. And so we need to continuously be pouring in. So do you find love? I don't believe you find love. I believe you build love. So love is something that you build. Yes, you find a human being that you're compatible with, that shares your vision, that shares your dreams, that that is able to meet your expectations and what have you. But do you actually just, you know, that's it? You just depend on that and you sit back? Absolutely not. What was the second part of your question?
The part is, you basically kind of answer, like, is there even love at first sight?
Yes. So you can be attracted. In the first instance, you can be attracted to a person. The hearts can sort of soften up and there is that connection. But, you know, once again, how many a times you might see a person that you might feel attracted to them, but as soon as they open their mouth, you know, Allah forbid, or, you know, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us all steadfast, you know, you feel, oh my God, I wish I didn't open up their mouth. Everything was looking so well, you know. But the attraction is there, but are you compatible? Do you share the same standards, values, beliefs that will allow you to enter and to make that transition and to go on this journey of life together?
I do want to like unpack that whole thing you talked about in regards to the person and being compatible. However, in the sense of, you know, talking about all these things in terms of finding the right person and whatnot and sharing your vision, us Muslims, you know, we're living in kind of a Western societal context. And so that kind of ideal, it sometimes becomes difficult in a sense, living in the current situation that we do. Whether it be, you know, through harm relationships or even bad relationships, marriages and relationships. So I think I even read a Facebook post, Sheikh Wissam. He made a status. He said in January 2018, he had nearly 100 cases of marriage dispute in 1 month. Basically, the average being 3 days. So do you feel like we, as a maybe even Muslim community, we don't have like a working model in regards to a successful marriage? And, you know, being a Muslim in the West, maybe that could be the underlying reason. Or would you argue the fact that everyone is different and that's why you can't expect all marriages to be kind of successful, that there will be marriage disputes, and that's why there is a lot of cases that, for example, Sheikh Wissam has, you know, kind of dealt with? And I hope, inshallah, it's not the same with you.
No, I mean, definitely most sheikhs are very, very busy. Actually, most of a sheikh's time throughout the week is probably, especially if he is dedicated to the community and servicing the community on the welfare level, you'll find them taking calls, messages, emails with regards to, you know, marital problems. And a lot of this, I guess, stems through not having the knowledge. So I think when it comes to healthy marriages, there are two very important elements to be mindful of in leading up to marriage. And the first one is insight, or having that knowledge about relationships, about human behavior, about gender differences. You see, Allah Azza wa Jalla does say that the male is not like the female. So we are different. It's not about who's better here. It's not about competing against one another, but it's understanding that Allah has blessed us with abilities and a skill set that allow us to complete one another as opposed to competing with one another. So a lot of it comes down to insight or knowledge about, you know, gender differences. We are different psychologically, neurologically, physiologically, biologically, the way we perceive the world. So it is about differences here. There definitely are differences. Now, if we don't understand differences, then there's going to be challenges. If we don't have knowledge about our roles, there's going to be challenges. You know, if we don't understand, for example, how to defuse situations, then there's going to be challenges and problems moving forward. I mean, in this day and age, there's a lot of there's a buzz phrase in this day of age, and that is EQ or EI, which is referred to as emotional intelligence. So what I've learned over the years is that people who are in a very healthy and non-toxic marriage, they have a lot of emotional intelligence, and this is something that as Muslims we should know this. From the Sunnah, from the Seerah, from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was sent to perfect good moral character. So I guess, subhanAllah, by being not having the knowledge, by not knowing, or what you don't know is probably going to damage your relationship. What you don't know. So we need to know how to be an outstanding husband, how to be an outstanding wife, spouse, and what are the contributors towards a fit marriage. So do we have a platform, do we have a resource to learn about how to be in an outstanding or amazing marriage? Of course we do. It's called the Quran. It's called the Sunnah. It's called study and analysis. It's called knowledge about relationships. And I know personally, subhanAllah, like alhamdulillah, after dissecting the Quran for relationship advice and dissecting the Sunnah for relationship advice, I didn't shy away from turning to modern day research about relationships, especially that there's a wealth of knowledge out there when it comes to human behavior, relationships. And at the end of the day, I think what we have to understand as well, that before we are of any faith or we are of any culture, we are human beings. And we have needs, we have emotions. And so we just need to, by having that emotional intelligence, and emotional intelligence is fundamentally about being able to, being aware of your own emotions, being having the knowledge of how to diffuse the emotion that you have, because for every emotion, there's going to be an action that you need to take, and you need to ensure that you're taking the right action. Yeah. Now, are you also aware of the emotion of the person in front of you? And do you know how to deal with that? Because if you don't know how to deal with that, then there can be fundamentally a problem. Mm. So if you're going to enter marriage and you're expecting it all to be rosy and the honeymoon period is going to last forever, then you're going to be in for a very rude shock. One of the things that I like to share with couples who are about to get married in the pre-marriage counseling that I also I'll just touch on in a moment is that be prepared for the ups and downs of a relationship, and that by being prepared for the ups and downs of a relationship, you've already won half of the battle. Yeah. So let's go back to what we were saying before: knowledge or insight, and that knowledge and insight comes about by you taking a proactive role in learning about relationships through pre-marriage counseling, which is, alhamdulillah, available through my office. It's available through certain community organizations. And so I know, for example, in countries like Singapore, Malaysia, you're not even allowed to get married until you undertake some sort of, marriage course. Right. I've actually read the statistics and how it actually contributes towards the success and longevity of marriages in those countries. And this is something I know that's in discussion in some of the Western countries, because you need to know, knowledge is empowering. So the first, we said contributor or element to combat this is knowledge. And the second one is communication. And what psychologists in one study noticed over a period of five, it's a five-year psychological study that was done. And during this study, I think it was between 2011 and 2015, they wanted to know what are the two major contributors of long-lasting healthy marriages. And it came down to knowledge and communication.
Mm-hmm. Sheikh, would you say that everything you've been saying about emotional intelligence and the importance of this knowledge and communication, would you say that that's the major part of why there's dysfunction in marriage, as opposed to the material conditions a couple may have. Would you say that's probably the most important thing?
As Muslims, I'd say that the most important thing is your relationship with Allah.
Allah, yeah.
Because let's get one thing straight here. Who controls the hearts?
Allah. Yeah.
Okay, where is love found? In the heart.
In the heart.
Okay, so yes, you do want to ensure that your relationship with the Creator, first and foremost, is a very strong one. The pious people of the past, they would say, repair your relationship with Allah, and He will repair your relationship with the creation. So there is a connection between your relationship with one another, okay, and your relationship with Allah. So therefore, taqwa, this concept of taqwa, of revering Allah Azza wa Jal, is a very important one when it comes to relationships. And we find the concept of taqwa being oft repeated in a chapter from the Quran called Surah At-Talaq. At-Talaq means divorce. And subhanAllah, in four or five times in this very surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the concept of taqwa, right? Now, in my sessions, my counseling sessions, consultations with couples, after the basic questions of who the people are, my first question always is, how is your relationship with Allah? Because that is going to set the scene for me as well. That's going to tell me about foundation. And subhanAllah, I find that maybe 8-9 times out of 10, there is shortcomings, there are flaws. Or for example, they don't pray, or they don't pray on time, or they don't pray at all. Okay. And then I think to myself, well, how am I going to help? How am I going to help if Allah has decreed for your relationship not to be a healthy relationship because of your shortcoming towards Him? And so when you subhanAllah build your relationship on a foundation of taqwa, of reverence of Allah, fear of Allah, God consciousness, right? When you build it on that foundation, then guess who's going to take care of your relationship?
Allah,
right? Now, but if you build your relationship on sin, on transgression, on dodgy behavior, on ill manners, then who's going to take care of your relationship? Shaitan, right? So there are a number of contributors, Brother Joshua, when it comes to healthy marriages and relationships, right? It's a lot of things. Have you done your due diligence in ensuring that you are with the right person who shares your dreams, passions, vision, etc.? Okay. Are you compatible? Have you communicated your needs on an emotional, physical, spiritual, social, financial level? So, do you understand human behavior? Have you communicated your values, your standards? There isn't this one contributor towards a healthy marriage.
Does that make sense? Would say that definitely there's the whole emotional intelligence side you were saying. But even before that, the basis you try to lay is that Islamic foundation, that we have to have taqwa and we have to have our ibadah in order. And then on top of that is where you'll have to build. Is that what you try to do?
Absolutely.
Get all that right first.
Yeah, I always like to start with the foundation. Like any building.
Yeah.
Okay. A building has a foundation, and marriage is no different. We need to set foundations. Okay. So the foundation for a healthy marriage, it's these pillars. Okay. Let's think about it as a structure. This house called marriage.
Yep.
Okay, the foundation, the pillars will include taqwa, will include compatibility, will include communication, will include, culture. There's cultural elements. There's a lot of things that, you want to make sure that you do your due diligence. I mean, think about it. When it comes to buying a car or something materialistic, we do so. We look at reviews, we ask around, we go shopping. And that's for something that's materialistic, right? Imagine then your marriage. Aren't you going to also do your due diligence? Have you done istikhara? Have you done istishara? Have you asked the people that know this person? Okay. So, we really want to make sure that we keep Allah Azza wa Jal as always our priority, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will assist us with the rest.
You brought up a point about before in terms of being attached to the Quran and Sunnah. And I feel like that is that's a big issue in the Muslim community as it is. And that issue kind of trickles down to things such as marriage, where you'll see that, you know, divorces are getting high and, you know, you see a lot of disputes amongst the families simply because, you know, it comes down to how's your relationship with Allah. And I feel like in the marriage, having that idea of I'm doing for the sake of Allah, it transcends just your marriage. It transcends everything. It makes it for the sake of Allah. And I think that is way more powerful in making a successful marriage. It's funny, like, I guess from a secular kind of Western side of things, people look like, oh, it's oppressive and it's all this. But subhanAllah, like, it liberates you kind of. It's like a freedom where you'll see like, no, this marriage is, I'm going to make it work, not just for the sake of my wife, for the sake of Allah, right? And I feel like that's the route that needs to be taken, because, you know, even being influenced by Hollywood, Bollywood, you name it, Dollywood, I think in Bangladesh,
Dollywood.
Yeah. SubhanAllah.
It's a new one.
Yeah, and it's just, what am I going to do for her, this, that, you know, I'm in love with her, and this, I was like, what about your love for Allah, you know? And then that will trickle down to loving her even more.
Absolutely. But what about your love for the one who's in control of your heart? Okay, what is, and when you do what Allah loves, He's going to bless you with what you love. And He's going to instill barakah. You know, barakah is blessing. He's going to instill blessing in your marriage. So subhanAllah, you know, some people are dealing with some very major sins. You know, I had a story recently from a couple whereby the sheikh comes to their home to try and solve their dispute and problems, and then he looks around the home and he says to them, oh, this is a new home. Did you purchase it through an Islamic bank or with your own money, or did you borrow from Western banking institute? And they said, oh, this is through a bank. So basically it's through riba. So the sheikh says, well, sell your home and your problems inshallah will be solved. And then he walked away.
That was it for him.
I wouldn't personally take that approach. I mean, I would incorporate that in the inshallah in trying to dissect and unpack this situation. But I mean, for him it was like, it basically is saying, well, look what you're doing. You've gone to war with Allah and you want barakah, you want blessing in your marriage. So yeah, we as Muslims cannot undermine the importance of the connection with Allah and a healthy marriage.
Allah. One thing I do want to kind of delve into, because we were talking a lot about husband, wife, and what the relationship should be and stuff. But one thing I guess that's not addressed, and especially Muslims living in today's society, is the idea of the age of our spouse. So I feel like this might vary from various Muslim communities, but I feel like not as much in the Bengali community. Like the whole idea, I think, in this day and age, living in the West, it's like you've got to be like a similar age to your spouse, or it's going down the Hollywood route. You know, they meet a guy meets a girl, they're similar age, they're just friends, and then they go, they like each other, they date, and it stems from the whole idea of they're the same age. Whereas probably like Josh, like would you reckon like back in Bangladesh, the man is probably like 10-15 years older, right?
Yeah, it just varies so much depending on the culture. Like in subcontinental cultures, it's typical for the girl to be 10-12 years younger, or even more for that fact. How would you say it is in Arab cultures, Sheikh?
More or less the same. I mean, I know myself being of an Arab background.
Yeah.
There's about 11 year difference between me and my wife.
Yeah.
So I'm older than her by about 11 years. And alhamdulillah, we have by the grace of Allah, we have a beautiful relationship, a very good relationship. And so I believe age is a number. I believe that if we really want to go back to the Islamic position, look no further than our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was married to Khadija, the love of his life, and he never got married to any other woman whilst he was married to her. And he married her when he was 25 and she was 40. So there's a 15-year difference where she is older than him. And then we look at another love of his wife sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Aisha. When he married her, he was a lot older than her. And here we have a time whereby the critics were out to bring down the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yet nobody was, we never read any reports about criticizing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for marrying either an older woman, Khadija, or a younger woman, Aisha, radiallahu anha. And we saw how much love they had for each other. They were very much in love. Yeah. So that's what we use to measure these type of questions. We use the sunnah, we use the hadith. So I believe that as long as there is this genuineness, the due diligence has been done and rights can be fulfilled, then I wouldn't really look at look at the number.
But the thing is, Sheikh, like, just living in our current context in like Western society and our generation as well, it just makes it really hard to sort of think about a spouse that's beyond like 5 years different to you. Do you get what I mean? As in, I think for your generation maybe, or the previous generations, yes, it was still sort of acceptable. But for us, it seems sort of really beyond the pale, as in you wouldn't get married to a girl that's 10 years younger. Maybe 3, 4, 5, but I don't know. How would you tell us, what would your advice be to us to sort of deal with that? Like, do you reckon just follow the sunnah and just marry any girl of any age, as long as you can fulfill the rights? Or should we keep in mind the sort of sensibilities of the culture here?
The resource or the source that I turn always back to is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, if it worked, you know, if it's worked for my generation,
yeah.
Thanks for making me feel a lot older than you.
Sheikh's young as well. He's young, but I mean, these are the boys.
So we're chillaxing here, alhamdulillah. if it worked, if it worked for our generation and the generations before us, why shouldn't it work for future?
Yeah.
Are we not all human beings?
Exactly. And are we not all Muslim?
Are we not all? That's still our. Yeah, that's really what we've got to look at. And look, in this day and age, it's very hard to get married because of the expectations, right? Now you've already, it's hard. And now you've made it harder on yourself by including this cultural expectation.
Yeah.
And subhanAllah, there's a lot of singles out there ready to mingle, and subhanAllah, they're finding it extremely hard. So let's not add to this. Let's try and keep it simple and make it easier for people to get married, inshallah.
Speaking about like expectations, one thing I do want to like ask you is the whole idea of expectations. Like, we have the whole, I think you can correct me if I'm wrong, like through the sunnah, it's like, you know, marry young, you know, a lot of barakah and all this and the blessings and whatnot. However, living in this kind of day and age, you know, living in Sydney, for example, everything's expensive. So your families just want, okay, the guy has a degree, has to be like, you know, at a full-time work, proper job, getting good income, has a house, and then get married. And then, start finding a wife after that and then get married. So I guess it's a very kind of different shift from maybe back in the times of during Rasulullah's time, where it was just like, yeah, let's marry, and, you know, regardless of age or whatnot. So do you feel like, how should we approach marriage in that context? And do you think that it's okay to not be, you know, financially stable before getting married, for example, because you can seek, you know, Allah will protect you and all that if you have, you know, the deen in check? Or do you think that, no, like in this day and age, all these things have to be laid out and then you can get married for the sake of, you know, her and looking after her and all that? So what's your kind of take on that?
Once again, let's go back to what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, ya ma'shar al-shabab. So here he addressed the shabab are the youth. Okay, and in Islam, you know, you're a youth anywhere between 15 and 33, or in some narrations, 40. He said, ya ma'ashar al-shabab, O youthful ones, whoever has the means. Okay, now the means here would mean anything that will be able to allow you to fulfill the rights of your spouse. Man istata'a minkum al-ba'a, the means, falyatazawwaj, then that person should get married. Okay, and then he mentions, فَإِنَّهُ أَغَضُّ لِلْبَصَرِ. Why? Because it helps marriage, helps restrain or lower the gaze, وَأَحْصَنُ لِلْفَرْجِ, and it safeguards, okay, or protects the private parts. From what? From committing zina, from committing fornication, you know. So, subhanAllah, we say, the youth, why is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam specifically addressing the youth here? Because the youth have a lot of energy. Okay, they're going to be easily attracted to the opposite gender. So what are we going to do? What are we going to do with this energy and with this desire, okay, that we have, especially in the West? You know, where many people are forgetting much of their clothes at home.
Subhanallah.
You know, or with the you know, the billboards, or with all the other things that we're surrounded by in a Western environment. You know, so I think we have to be realistic in our approach. Why can't I, as a university student or a college student, okay, be married and study at the same time? Maybe that will make me more focused, okay? Maybe that will contribute towards my success, because it's going to be barakah in my life, because I'm not going to be committing any haram with the desire that I have, because I'm fulfilling half of my deen, as the Prophet ﷺ said that when you get married, you complete half of your deen. And I don't have this anxiety with regards to the opposite gender or my desire or, you know, getting married. Alhamdulillah, I'm married. I've got someone to support me, to help me, to that will, you know, be there for me. So why does it have to be that way? Why does it have to be that you have to complete, you know, your study? Why can't you start off with a one-bedroomer somewhere? And remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, subhanallah, has taken it upon himself to support the one, there's in one hadith, to support the one who wants to get married for the sake of protecting his chastity or her chastity and modesty, right? Allah's going to help you. If you have clear intentions and if you have sincerity and there's genuineness and you're prepared to fulfill the rights of that person, why are we making it difficult for our children, for our siblings? Why are we making it difficult for them and easy for the shaitan?
So okay. Do you think, like, because you're saying, like, I think a lot of people, like, Muslim and young, and if they're practicing, they do want to get married young, especially, like, living in this kind of context. But the biggest hurdle is because of either the spouse's parents or their own parents, where they say, like, you have to be established in full-time work and get your degree and all that. So if, for example, maybe the person you're interested is interested in you, but these obstacles are basically your parents, right? How do you kind of navigate through that, you know? Well, can you give us me
because at the same time you can't go against your parents, can you?
Well, you want to always include your parents. Yeah. You know, you don't want to go against, your parents. It's going to hurt them. It's going to give them much anxiety. There's going to be lots of friction. So what you'd want to do is you'd want to, first of all, maybe have a talk with them. Yeah. Maybe what you can do first is speak to the parent who's more going to be on your side. All right. Look, it is about strategy. We need to strategize here, guys. We need to strategize, right?
Winning will battle so for nothing. Huh? No?
Is this what your advice would be? Yeah. That we actually have to be strategic?
Of course, absolutely. Okay. Of course. Because if you're not strategic, this can really have some ramifications, serious ramifications, right?
How do you think, like, Rasul Salam won all those wars, bro? He's got to, like, strategize.
Strategy for
absolutely.
Everything.
So let's talk marriage strategies here, okay? So I think the first thing is find the parent that is more inclined to support you. Okay, go to that parent, massage the idea. Don't, you know, maybe you know, maybe you know, first of all, and do it in a way that doesn't give them a shock as well, you know.
So or just suggest it to them.
Suggest it to
as
them
opposed and, to being like, I want to do this.
That's it, yeah. You know. So start to just, you know, build it up, you know, yeah. Build the case up, and then so by the time you come, they've already got some sort of idea, yeah. And they've already been prepared, right? So now, okay, let's say you've come up to the parent, and now the parent is going to say, okay, well, let me speak to your dad. Let's say it's mum. You know, it could be the other way around, by the way. So now mum's going to speak to dad, and then, you know, and then dad's going to basically, you know, the fit is going to hit the shan. Sorry. That's the halal version of it. So basically then, you know, dad's going to get really mad, and, you know, he's going to say, no, I'm not having any part of this. No way. You got to finish your study. It could be either finish out your study, or you're only marrying a person from our country, not only our country, but also our village. And it happens. It happens.
No, that's
we
serious,
know this, right? Yeah. So there are expectations. See, what happens? Why are parents getting so disappointed? It's because of their blueprint. It's because of their expectation that they've created for themselves or that they've carried on from the previous generations, right? And then our generation is now copying it, right? So now the key is what happens next? Dad's not having a bar of it. Okay, so what are we going to do? Well, this is where we'll get a relative, an elder that may be able to influence dad. Okay, well,
this is a mad strategy.
Okay.
I didn't think of this.
I haven't thought of this part. Okay.
So we're getting the elder. We have to do one of those, is it matrixes? And, you know, then we'll talk to an elder. The elder fails, all right? And then we'll come to maybe the imam that the father is influenced by and looks up to.
Yeah.
So now the imam comes in, you get him in, and you give the father a call, salam alaikum, look, I've heard, you know, your
the news has been going around.
Picks up the phone, it's like,
you know,
who's this?
Yeah, who's this? You know, it's the imam from the local masjid, or, you know, and we'd just like to sit down and talk with you, you know. What's the problem? What are your fears? What's going on here? You know, and just talk them through the situation, talk them through it, maybe give them some references, and, you know, you'd go from there. Now, in a situation, let's talk about an extreme situation for a moment, okay, whereby the imam's gotten into it, you know, mum's gotten into it, the elder's gotten into it, the imam's gotten into it, and dad is still, okay, dead set against you getting married. And, you know, and you're all hormonal, and the desires are up, and... you know, what do you do then? So, you know, if you, this is a very genuine question, that if you fear that you're going to fall into haram, because let's be real here, this is something that happens in the West, okay? What are you going to do? Are you going to fall into haram and put it on your dad's neck? I'll just say, yeah, Allah, it's my dad's fault. Does that work?
You can't do
that. Is that allowed?
Yeah, no.
No, it's not allowed. So now, if you really, really just can't, you can't do it, then this is where you take your case to a senior imam. Like the mufti of your area,
get
or a
the big guns,
the big guns. Yeah, you got to go to the big guns here, right? And then they will actually call the father, and they will say, "Hey, your daughter is here." Because remember, you can't get married. We're addressing here the ladies.
Yeah.
They can't get married without a wali.
Yeah.
Okay. As the Prophet ﷺ said, there's no valid marriage without a wali, right? So now they'll go to this big gun imam, and now the imam is going to make that phone call. And maybe meet, you know, subpoena the dad and say, hey, come here, we've got to talk. And if he says, what are your reasons for not allowing your daughter to get married to this man? Do you have Islamic reasons? Tell me. And if he starts, you know, if, for example, the man, he's got, alhamdulillah, he's blessed with enough wealth to have, to be in a marital, in a relationship, and he has a good character, and he has deen. Okay, and I think these are three or four things that I highly recommend when you're looking for an ideal spouse, or in the case of a suitor. The Prophet ﷺ said that when the suitor comes to you and you're happy with their deen and you're happy with their manners, then offer your daughter in marriage, accept the proposal. And if you don't do so, what did he say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, تَكُنْ فِتْنَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ عَرِيضٌ. There's going to be a fitna. There's going to be turmoil. There's going to be problems, okay, on the earth. Or fasad, and a great deal of injustice, or injustice, or fasad, or corruption. So now the imam, now the head imam, will now say to the parent, well, look, either you're going to be the wali, or I'm going to be the wali. Okay, but that has to be the call of, you know, the imam in these cases. But then again, the girl must be very, very sure that she's done her due diligence. Because if anything goes wrong in the marriage, and dad and the family want to ostracize her, okay, and things go bad, it's going to be even more problematic, yeah, trying to get back in. So it can be a bit of a complicated scenario. That's why ideally we want the parents on board, and we want to use strategies, and we want to seek the assistance and guidance of the people around, the well-versed people in relationships around us, that can guide us to the best course of action.
So do you feel like... even if, okay, for example, maybe the parents wanted that kind of certain criteria of their daughter to marry a son, for example, like arbitrary kind of rules, for example, you know, they have to be same village and all that, but they happen, all this process happens, and Sheikh comes and this, they just agree, like, okay, but it's not like they really want it kind of deep down, you get me? But
yes,
it's like,
yes.
Okay, yes, Islamically this is good and all that.
Mm-hmm.
He's right, like, because you want your kind of parents to be on board, and, you know, the emphasis of parents, you know, their rights and all that in Islam.
Yeah.
Do you feel like Allah will still provide blessings in that marriage, even though the parents aren't like fully 100%?
They're still somewhat bitter about the situation, but they've given their permission.
Absolutely. So, yeah. And I've seen many, many cases whereby parents were bitter and they were against the suitor, for example.
Yeah.
Okay. And subhanAllah, only to learn later that the parents and the suitor became very, very good with one another, and they lived happily ever after, and that was the end of it.
Oh, really? Wow.
But see, you've got to be prepared to go through. I think this is where if you've done your due diligence. I want to keep on stressing on that you've really made sure that you're marrying the right person. Then we'll take it up to the next level. But if you're not sure, then keep on assessing. And when you're sure, then you either take it up or you let go. Because it can be really, really bad otherwise for you. Once you want to go to the next level, like I said, I've seen many cases whereby it will take some time, and subhanAllah, the parents come around and it's one big happy family. Okay, and that's if you're genuine and if you have sincerity and you're upping the ante with istighfar, upping the ante with your dua, okay, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put the barakah in it. So the parents' dissatisfaction in this scenario is not going to be warranted in terms of contributing to the lack of blessing in the marriage, because it's based on something which is baseless. It's not Islamic.
Yeah, it's just their own.
It's culture. Biases. It's biased. It's what they've created or they've taken on from the previous generations.
And also in regards to you quoted that hadith a while back, and you said, Rasulullah said, O youth, if you have the means.
If you have the means.
Okay, so I want to focus on the word means, right? Because means could be, you know, I don't know, finance, for example, or whatnot.
Mm.
And you mentioned even before that, you know, why not live in a one-bedroom apartment? Do you feel like with the means, like, there needs to be the rights for your spouse? Like, if you're looking to find a wife and you have to make sure that your wife has to have this. And if you don't have that on a financial level, do you think there still be blessings in the marriage, even though you can't facilitate for all her kind of needs? Do you think the marriage will still work and Islamically it's still fine to go ahead about that marriage in particular?
Well, you know, having the means would be to be able to offer this qawama, or the protection and well-being of the spouse, being able to give them their rights on a physical level, to be able to give them their rights on the financial level. And this is the husband providing for his wife. So again, he would need to communicate what sort of, what will be the standard of living. So let's say, for example, because she may come from an affluent family and she's used to having very luxurious, lifestyle. Then all of a sudden this suitor comes along and he is not able to give her that sort of a lifestyle. Now, is she prepared to radically accept this? He needs to be honest with what he can offer, and she needs to be honest whether she will accept this offer or not. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And then really it's up to her to accept the standard of living. And if she accepts it, then alhamdulillah. So it's going to be more so coming from the wife or the potential wife and her expectations, and she's communicating everything to the suitor, and he is communicating everything to her. Transparency is key. Be transparent. Don't assume. Otherwise, what I've learned when it comes to divorce statistics is a lot of relationships, they do fail, they do end up in divorce because of failed expectations. So expectations, make sure that you communicate your expectations. I keep on saying this because I see this as, I believe that a lot of the divorces that are taking place in a lot of cases is that there is failed expectations. I entered this relationship, okay, thinking it's going to be like 1, 2, and 3.
Yeah.
And then I enter it and it's not like I expected. It's not like the blueprint that I had in my subconscious mind. And so therefore I am disappointed. And so when disappointment kicks in, it's going to affect you emotionally.
Yeah.
And then it's going to affect you physically. And it goes from there.
SubhanAllah. And one thing I do want to kind of mention as well is the idea of, okay, for example, they're married and alhamdulillah, it's all good. And we have this whole culture of such extravagant weddings. So like, you know, you go to receptions, this insane amount of money, you know, there's that expectation as well to kind of spend all that money because you want like, I don't know, 1,000 guests to rock up. Do you feel like Allah will provide kind of blessings in that marriage for such extravagant kind of weddings? Or do you feel like if the person can, you know, realistically afford it, it's not too much because they're very wealthy, then fine. But the whole ideal of the process of getting married should be, you know, very normal and not too extravagant and very simple, kind of humble method and way of going about the whole wedding.
Well, the basic principle in Islam is to avoid extravagance. This concept of overspending is one that goes against this Islam. So again, if we're going against the injunction, then where is the barakah going to be? So everything is in moderation. And yeah, if a person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed them with much wealth, and they have the means to host a walima, then host it. But always keep in mind, no excess, nothing that, because this excess can be used, for many people around the world. Like I saw, for example, during the initial stages of the Syrian crisis, I saw a couple, a Turkish couple, I think it was, and they were getting married. She was in her wedding dress and he was in his, suit. And the way that they were celebrating their wedding was near some, refugee camp. And they were just handing out food. Can you imagine the barakah
such... Yeah, the barakah.
That's foundation, right? Can you imagine the barakah of this marriage? Where you start off, you're helping people, you're contributing to the lives of others, and Allah's going to contribute now to your relationship. That's barakah. We've got to think outside, outside the square, outside the box, and really be looking at, long-term, looking at this long-term and not looking at the short-term. At the end of the day, no matter how extravagant your wedding is or your walima is, there will always be the people who will be critical, who will talk about, there's always going to be the critics.
Yeah, I think when people have those extravagant weddings, their main idea is to have a good opinion of them. But the thing is, people will always say negative things. It's just how society is.
Yeah,
and they'll criticize one thing or the other.
Yeah, and that money that you're going to spend, surely you can. There's lots of beautiful ideas out there. You could actually say, look, you can send everybody. You can have something really humble, and what you can do is you can maybe have let's say for example a $50 voucher or a $100 voucher with a person's name on it, and say, hey everybody, we could have had an extravagant wedding, what we've done on your behalf, we've donated $50 such and such charity.
Such that
imagine how happy they are. Yeah. So you get the rewards. Now, do you think people are going to talk about these people? Do you think Allah is going to allow for people to talk about them?
Even if they do say something negative about it, it's like you're sort of decrying something that's like a reward in your behalf. As in, like, what do you have to say about it?
Exactly.
your way out of this. It's giving you rewards. Like, what do you have to say?
Absolutely. So let's build our marriages on taqwa, on barakah, on the love of Allah, on the love of His Messenger Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, through due diligence, through mawadda, passionate love, through rahmah, mercy, through all of these contributors.
Just to shift gears a little bit, Sheikh, like another topic we wanted to touch on was intercultural marriages. So what is your experience with them, and have you seen them to be successful in the West, or are there particular problems that those couples go through?
I think, subhanAllah, in a lot of my interactions through counseling, through celebrancy, I really cannot say that I've seen any problems with intercultural marriages.
So would you say more of the problems come from marriages within the same culture or like different expectations?
No, I can't even say that. It's not related to culture. Okay. It's not related to culture. It's related to a lack of due diligence. It's related to lack of taqwa, maybe a lack of compatibility. Now, so compatibility doesn't have to be, has anything to do with the culture. Okay. But then again, it might be in terms of when you were communicating with one another, were there cultural issues that or standards or beliefs that you have that go against the other person's?
Yeah.
So that should be established before you enter the relationship.
Or even things like a lack of communication with the in-laws. Because if your parents are from different cultures, they might have problems communicating. If they're not particularly
I do see tensions. So let me say something. I do sometimes definitely see tensions between the parents.
Yeah.
So definitely I do see those tensions. But then the children don't have an issue. Why?
Because they're totally fine.
Exactly. Because society. They grew up in the same community, same society. SubhanAllah. There has been a shift. But I honestly, in all honesty, I cannot say the problems, that the major problems are related to cultural differences. No. I remember in one study that I came across, which was from a Muslim community, talking about divorce statistics and divorce-related matters, and there were like 15 reasons. okay, that why a lot of couples end up getting divorced, and I do not recall seeing cultural differences.
Oh,
there you go.
I guess we actually touched on so many different things, and I hope, especially from the youth, like they'll benefit a lot from this kind of conversation, inshallah. Especially like go right to the sheikh and get them on board. I'm taking that advice.
We have a game plan now. Exactly which level.
Now we know how to approach a marriage and the idea, and you know, even just strengthening your relationship with Allah to make your marriage successful, inshallah. So thank you so much for your time, Sheikh. Hope you enjoyed your time here on Boys in the Cave.
I loved it. I loved every bit of it, inshallah. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless your initiative and your Amen. Efforts and this program. Amen, and to all the youth that are listening, you know, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep you all steadfast and to inspire and to guide you to that which will bring about massive success in this worldly life and massive success in the hereafter. Don't be hasty, be patient, do your due diligence, do be good communicators, inshallah ta'ala. So these are all things that will really assist you moving forward in making that transition in building a healthy home. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring about best for all of us.
Ameen, ameen. For all our listeners, thank you so much for giving us your attention. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to email us at boysinthecave@gmail.com, or you can find us on Facebook, and you can also follow our journey through Instagram and Twitter. Please leave us a 5-star rating on iTunes, as that greatly helps us. As I always tell my team here, inshallah, I want us to, you know, strive to be the biggest podcast in Australia, because I feel like the potential is really big, especially with the guests like we had today, inshallah, we can grow. So from our special guest, Sheikh Bilal Danoon, aka The Love Doctor, Josh and myself, we wish you all the best. This is Tanzim, signing off. Assalamu alaikum.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وربطنا على قلوبهم إذ قاموا فقالوا ربنا رب السماوات والأرض لن ندعو من دونه إلها لقد قلنا إذا شططا هؤلاء قومنا اتخذوا من دونه آلهة لولا يأتون عليهم بسلطان بين فَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنِ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا